Tain't so, honey, tain't so. The devil said yes, but the Lord said no. Tain't so, honey, tain't so.
Well, hello there. My name is Matt Shelley, and I'd like to make a video tonight, something special I've been wanting to do for a long time, and that is to do a brief, maybe 10-minute history of one of my favorite hobbies, that's antique phonographs. I haven't really seen a video like this, so I decided to do one on my own. And that is basically to cover phonographs from the invention from Thomas Edison in 1877 up to about 1930. With the electrification, full electrification, and early record changers. So let's start with the first, and that would be, of course, 1877. Thomas Edison invented the tinfoil phonograph. No electricity whatsoever, purely acoustic. Tinfoil was the media that was used, or the medium that was used. And I actually made a home version, sort of just from plywood, you know, sort of a little homemade science project. I kind of made my own. And the old Mary had a little lamb trick with my own little twist. So check this out.
Old Mother Hubbard went to the cupboard to get her old dog a bone. She bent over, Rover took over. She got a bone of her own. Eggies! Eggies! Eggies!
Action. Was fun. So as you can see, that's the fundamental original Edison technology. Moving on to the next advance would basically be Edison, spurred on by Alexander Graham Bell and his cronies in the 1880s, who developed their own version of the phonograph, and it eventually became the Columbia Company. Here I have an Edison fireside machine, and it's just basically the same as the tinfoil, except that this actually has a single spring motor, and of course it sounds a lot better, and the recordings are a lot clearer than tinfoil. Anyway, I'll play you a little bit of that, of a video of me playing this very fireside. So to move on, now we get to the disc machines, the disc phonographs that were created in the 1890s, originally by a German named Emil Berliner, who came up with the idea, the invention first for disc technology. He never really perfected it, but he did make a rather crude machine that existed in the 1890s. And basically what happened with Berliner is he kind of sold off his rights to young guy in Philadelphia, or in Philadelphia Camden area, named Eldridge Johnson, who founded the Victor Talking Machine Company. The Victor Talking Machine Company took off pretty quickly, and the flat disc became pretty much the industry standard. And the advantages of the discs just simply outweighed the cylinders for the average consumer, and so they quickly jumped ahead in terms of sales and popularity. Let's watch a video of one in action. Thank you. addition to Victor, by the way, there were other companies that were beginning to spring up, but mostly it was between Victor and Columbia at that time in the early part of the 20th century, the first decade. And Columbia was making their own machines, very similar. And that was pretty much it. The competition was pretty slim at that point. We move on to the internal horn machines, and Victor Talking Machine Company invented the internal horn machine, and it was called the Victor Victrola. It was an instant hit. It was very expensive, about $250 for the original ones, and back then it was a lot of money. But they took off very rapidly, very quickly. They were just more convenient, easier to clean, easier to blend in the house as a piece of furniture, and they're beautiful machines. So why don't we watch the video of my, it's not a VTLA, mine's actually a 16, mine's a 1909 Victor Victrola 16. Take it. After the success of the internal horn machine by Victor, that's when other companies began to spring up, right before and particularly after World War II. Many, many companies, literally hundreds of companies, furniture makers, piano makers across the country. Some of the more well-known ones were Brunswick. Brunswick, Balky, Callender, Cheney, again, Columbia's, the Victor's, and even Edison got in the game eventually with what they called a diamond disc machine. And it remained that way for, like I said, most of the teens. And then what started to happen, really the only difference that occurred next would have been just cabinet design. Some manufacturers started making flat console cabinets instead of the uprights like the VTLA. And they became very popular. Victor got into that game actually a little bit later. They kind of stuck with the uprights a little bit longer, and their competitors were beginning to manufacture these consoles. And so Victor got into the game. And the first Victor attempt at a kind of flat top was what we call now humpback. And I have one of those. I have a VV260. And I actually love the machines. Collectors don't like them, but I think they're beautiful machines. I think they're fascinating looking. And I have, like I said, I have a VV260 in wonderful shape. And we will watch that now. Thank you. Yeah, so the flat tops started to become a very popular alternative to the uprights that had been previously the big sellers. But essentially, the thing to remember about all the flat tops from all the manufacturers at that point and the uprights is that they're identical in terms of the actual technology, the playback technology. We're still dealing in the acoustic era here, so everything's recorded actually with horns and recorded acoustically in the studios. And then, through a Western Electric process, a recording process, there needed to be invented in the early 20s, 23, 24, somewhere in there. They had approached, Western Electric had approached Victor originally, and then roughly around the same time they had approached Brunswick and Columbia with their recording technology. But they needed a playback system on the phonograph. And we're still talking about non-electric here, so it still had to be an acoustic reproduction, but something had to be done to accommodate the newer frequencies, the broader frequency ranges of the newly recorded electric recorded records with the invention of the microphone. So removing the horn, bringing in the microphone, and electrically recording records brought a tremendous improvement in fidelity, and it had to be compensated somehow in the actual playback. So when Victor got into it in 1925, they unveiled what they called the orthophonic system. And it's a beautiful system. It still sounds great to this day. Purely acoustic, and just some changes in the reproducer and some major changes in the horn, what they called an exponential horn, where they actually sort of made a 6-foot, their largest one, the Credenza, which I have over here, which I will show you in a minute, took a 6-foot horn and sort of divided it up and crunched it up, this wood horn. Again, it's called an exponential horn. So if you laid it out, it would be 6 foot, but it was carved in such a way that it fits into roughly a 3.5-4 foot cabinet, which is still huge. But the combination of that new and improved metal diaphragm with the exponential horn really blew away anything that had come before it in terms of acoustic phonographs. And it was an industry sensation. And the Credenza was their flagship. And again, that's the one that I have. And again, still to this day, you listen to it and it's incredible, the sound that comes out of this machine. And it's a huge machine. So anyway, instead of yapping about the Credenza, and then I'll talk a little bit about some of the other companies, let's watch the Credenza now. So the Credenza was Victor's flagship. That was their largest machine. But there were other companies that got into it as well. Brunswick was also approached by Western Electric, actually, I think slightly earlier, and Columbia was as well. Columbia developed what they called a vivatonal system, and also Brunswick. They came up with their version called the Panatrope. And it was, again, a similar system, just slightly different designs for patent reasons and this and that. But that system just blew away the old phonographs, and that tinny, boxy sound was gone. And now you really did have a tremendous improvement. It wasn't small by any means, a tremendous improvement over the sound. And you really have to be in front of one to appreciate the sound today. As the video I just played of the Credenza, you can hear the difference slightly if you're comparing it, but you have to really be in the room to be able to hear it. So the irony of the Credenza, or the orthophonic system, and its competitive offshoots, the Panatrope, the Vivatonal, etc. There were other companies that attempted similar systems. They didn't last very long. Surprisingly, they actually only lasted, really their heyday was only about 2 or 3 years tops. By 1928, they were pretty much gone. So one of the things that also occurred during that period was as radio gained popularity, the phonograph companies began to couple up with the radio companies, mostly RCA at that time. RCA had coupled up with Brunswick and Victor, and they began to make console models that would have both radio and phonograph in it, basically an entertainment center. And I have a machine called an Alhambra, which was made by Victor in 1926, and it's a mid-size orthophonic reproduction phonograph on one side, still purely acoustic, no Electrola there. And on the left-hand side was a beautiful radiola made by RCA. They were probably the most popular radios at that time, the radiolas, and they were very good, high quality, really good stuff, and they sound great to this day. Anyway, without me talking any further, take a listen and a look at my Alhambra. Fully electric machines. Like I said, they're pretty much dominated by 1928-29. The acoustic orthophonic type systems had pretty much run their course pretty quickly within 2 or 3 years. So they faded out pretty quickly. And the electric reproduction came into existence pretty fast as the parts became cheaper. And it made a huge improvement even over the orthophonics. And particularly because, again, just the electronic production reproduction gave you more control in volume, and the sound just did improve once they got that technology down pretty good. So let's take a look and a listen to my RE57 by Victor, 1930, let's say. Enjoy. Enjoy. From acoustic to electric, and the only thing that, again, that really needed to happen at this point, and it did happen pretty quickly, there had been some changing mechanisms earlier with acoustics, with cylinders predominantly. I know Edison and a few other companies actually designed one, and they were for commercial use, you know, just like they would be today, like jukeboxes. But really, any kind of home version, they were very, very expensive, and any kind of home version of a record changer just wasn't attempted at that point. It didn't take long after electric reproduction was introduced by Brunswick and Victor et al. That changers began, and I believe Victor made the first changer. Their first couple of designs were interesting, some cumbersome, more cumbersome than other ones. Some of them flung records around it. You'd think, my God, they're just going to, you know, shatter these shellac records. But they're fascinating. And I will show you two changers. One of the very first designs, and I think the next one is either the second or third Victor design, a much more elegant design. It's much softer on the records. But these are fascinating. I think you'll enjoy this. So watch these.
Thank you.
Wasn't that cool? That is the shit, man. I love those things. I can't wait till I get one. But anyway, so the changers pretty much marked the last fundamental change in disc record technology. Again, most of the changes after 1930 came on in the discs, the records themselves, long playing, stereo, etc. So those don't really change the fundamental technology. So by this point, it was pretty much set in stone the way phonographs were going to work for the next several decades until the advent of laser and CDs. So I hope you enjoyed this video of the early history of phonographs and records. And so thank you very much for watching, and cheers.
Tain't so, honey, tain't so. The devil said yes, but the Lord said no. Tain't so, honey, tain't so.